I'm weak and I need thy strength and power.
Yes,
to help me o'er my weakest hour. Bear me through the darkness thy face to see. Lead me. Oh Lord, lead me. As we prepare to honor the request of our pastor. He said that the church would mourn for 30 days.
Yes.
And then the church should move on. The unveiling ceremony is a moving on ceremony. As Pastor Herbert has preached this morning, as I was, so I shall be. I will not. As I was with Moses, so I shall be with Joshua. I will not leave you nor forsake you. So as we come to this moment, there was a reason that God took Moses and hid his body.
That's right.
And the reason was He did not want the people to make an idol out of Moses.
All right now.
We have to caution you when we come to this ceremony. Because it would be a real easy move to make an idol out of Pastor Carl Washington Senior. And St. Timothy's. It would be contrary to everything he taught. Satan has a way of creeping into the middle of your grief and having you create idols out of individuals. Nobody was closer to him than Pastor Minnie. And nobody looked more like him than me. But he didn't die for my sin. He always pointed me to who died for my sin. So as we come to this moment, we're taking down the symbols of mourning.
Yes.
And we are moving into the next episode of the St. Timothy's Christian Baptist Church. Episode 1. 47. This is season 2. This is episode 1. Whenever the next season comes, there's going to be change. Because in order to keep the ministry alive, change has got to occur. So as we bow our heads at this moment, and once we bow our heads and have this prayer, the deacons and deaconess, St. Timothy's Church, will follow me out front. We will remove from the front of the church the symbols of mourning.
Yeah.
We come back in, we will have the hymn, Be Begotten, sung by Reverend Carmi Flood. After that, we will remove the shroud from the altar and have reflections by Pastor Minnie. After that, the robe will be removed from this chair by Pastor Minnie and the sons and daughters of Pastor Carl Washington, Sr. Then the hymn of praise, the prayer of commitment and benediction by our pastor.
Amen.
Dr. Minnie R. Washington, our pastor.
Amen.
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 Let's bow our heads. Seems like only yesterday that your laughter filled the air. And whatever I was going through, you were always there. How you gave of all your love and time to those who were in need. In my heart, you'll always be a part of me. Though sometimes it's hard to deal with you not being here, I rejoice that you have reached that place of peace where there is no fear. Heaven has become a little sweeter just because you're there. And we'll meet again in that place so bright and fair. I'll see you again.
Yes, I will.
Where the sun is always shining. I'll see you again where sorrows are no more.
Yes, Lord.
Where we'll join hands together and we'll sing around the throne.
Yes.
Can't hardly wait until the day I'll see you again. Till we meet. Till we meet.
Well.
Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet.
Well.
Till we meet again. God be with you.
Yeah.
Till we meet again. God our Father, we come now. At this moment, God, to remove the signs of grief.
Yes.
And we ask, Father God, that as we remove the signs of grief, we will focus on your guarantee.
Yes, yes, Lord.
You guaranteed us that you've prepared a place for us. You've guaranteed us that when this flesh is eaten by skin worms, yet in our own flesh shall we see God.
Yes, Lord.
You guaranteed us a new home and a new body. And so, God, as we remove the signs of grief, we rest in your guarantee.
Yes,
now keep us, God, in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you. Pastor Washington has said that we are removing the symbols of grief. This next item that we will remove is Pastor Washington's robe. Certainly, I have never worshiped my husband, but I sure do love him a lot. I said to my youngest son yesterday that I wanted to be your mouthpiece today and let you know just exactly what he thought of you, as if you didn't know. You saw him preach in this robe and in several others that he has in the office. You heard him preach from Genesis to Revelation. And more than once, you heard him talk about that city that Reverend Herbert talked about today. In fact, the last 2 years of his preaching, he sat right down there and preached Revelation. And he let us know that he was not afraid to die. In fact, reading many of his sermons, I saw that he truly preached his eulogy over and over and over again. And this robe that we're going to touch today carries precious memories. For the man who wore it was a preacher's preacher. He was called to be a preacher. And he proved his calling in his home. He was saying first. And he went before God and he asked him, because he knew he had a stubborn wife at that time. And he asked him to touch me and to save me. And without witnessing a word to me, God answered his prayer. Because God keeps his promises. He promised that if we ask anything in his name according to his will, that he would answer. And on the third Saturday, 1957, as I sat on the couch with my husband, your pastor, the Lord saved me, and I praise him for my husband. He was called to be a pastor and a preacher. He preached everywhere. That's why when people would come to me in St. Timothy's and say, I've been called to be a preacher, well, there's plenty of preaching ground. You don't have to get a license to be a preacher. He preached everywhere. Public places, hedges and highways, parks and streets, the prisons, the hospitals. And he preached with such fervor that the worst of people would come crying, what must I do to be saved? A man spat in his face one day out in the park. He kept preaching with his Bible in his hand. The man tried to get other people away from the crowd, but God wouldn't let the man get away. And at the end of the service, guess who came forward and gave his life to Christ? As many of you have done, when you heard him preaching the powerful word of the gospel. His ministry started in the Gospel of John. And so when Dr. Washington Jr. came to us, that's what he preached. For God so loved the world that he gave his only, that whosoever should not perish, but St. Timothy knows the word. Because it was required of Pastor Washington. As Dr. P.M. Smith said, he set a standard, and we had to live by that standard. His ministry then was repeatedly preached the love of God in Christ Jesus. He repeatedly reminded us that we need the power of the Holy Spirit. He repeatedly called us to seriously study God's word. To study God's word, not his word, but God's word. He was definitely not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He regarded the seriousness of his call to pastor according to Jeremiah 3:15. And we were reminded that God gave us a pastor, not the kind that men wanted to have, because there were people who walked away from him because he wouldn't sell things in the church. And it would allow them to turn this into a place of merchandise. There were other people who left him because he wouldn't let them turn it into a place of entertainment. And there are other people who left him because they just couldn't stand the word of God. But everybody who left got something. And further down the road, they remembered what he had preached. And wherever they are today, they are tots among the leadership in whatever church they're in. As a pastor, he captured the hearts of his entire congregation. And although all of you are not here today, you know that's right. He captured them. They loved him. They not only listened seriously to the word of God from him, but they loved to hear his jokes. And Chris, all the time, some of them were not funny, but they laughed. He was a wonderful, happy, jovial, joyful pastor. And he loved his little son being quiet. He sang with them, "I don't want to be a goat." Nope. He sang with little Emma, "God wants to spend time with you, just you." But his favorite at the end was, "I believe in God, I believe in God, I believe," hallelujah. And they came to sing that to him on his birthday. So as we remove this robe, St. Timothy's, our pastor's robe, I want you to know, and I'll say something you already know, he viewed you as his very own children. Am I right?
Amen.
Yes, he did. He loved you with an everlasting love. He assured you of the love and forgiveness of God. And in our weakness, he encouraged us to do the work of a disciple. He called us to be an ambassador. He called us to be a witness. And he called us to be about our Father's business. And we heard him preach all of this in this robe that we are about to remove. We're not worshiping the robe, but we will keep it as a wonderful memento, a wonderful memory of the many times we heard him say, "This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasure is laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore." And so I will quote from one of his sermons that I've been reading this week. The title of the sermon is "The Everywhereness of God." In that sermon, he said how he had tried, well, to hide Quinton from God. He said, but he found out that he couldn't hide from God. And he joined David in saying, "If I ascend up into heaven, God is there. If I go down to hell, hell is not a witness to God. God is there. If I go to the uttermost parts of the sea, God is there. Even there will he find me." And then he said, as he closed, "I'm going where that God is." He said, "I'm going up to that city." He called it the city four square. 12 gates, he said, to the city. Streets are paved with gold in the city. And then he would wave those big arms, and in that big voice, he would say, "I'm going up, 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 up to the city where there's no death, no pain." And then he would look out at the congregation and say, "Won't you come and go with me?" That's how he closed that message. "To my Father's house, I want you to meet me there." And you heard him say that so many times. So as we touch this robe, I and the sons and daughters of St. Timothy's. St. Timothy's, wherever you are today, you're touching it through us. It's a robe that you touched many times. You cried on that robe. He held you close on that robe and prayed for you. He grieved with you. And the little children, he hugged them close to his bosom and prayed with them. We're removing his robe today. We will never remove his memory from our hearts. But we will worship the true and living God. God bless you.
My faith looks up to thee, the Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray. Take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be holy thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire, as thou hast died for me. Oh, may my love to thee pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. Holy Father in heaven, your servant, Carl Washington, Sr., has put me in a place whereby I must be fully committed to carry out your will for the rest of my life. And so, Lord, in Jesus' name, before you, your Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus, before angels in this assembly, my Father, I commit myself wholly and solely to you. I commit myself, Lord God, to be prepared to move toward the way you have paid for me. And whatever the cost, my husband told me I can't turn to the right nor to the left. I can only go up the straight and narrow. Yes. And so, Lord, as I go, I have the comfort of knowing that the same way you went with Carl Washington Sr., you will go with me.
Yes.
And Lord, forsakes me, I don't have to worry, because I know that when you go with me, you are more than the world against me. I thank you today. I thank you for giving me the courage not to back out. I thank you for the encouragement he gave me even on his sickbed to say to me, you don't have to ask me what to do. You know what to do. You go to God. And then I thank you for this flock at St. Timothy's. This is your flock. We are your people, your sheep. We are parts of your body. So I understand, Lord God, that as their leader, I am handling the holy. And I ask you in the name of Jesus to give me the privilege to serve them your way, Lord, not mine, but yours. And as I close this prayer, Father, leaning and depending on you, I ask you to take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of your love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful. Take my heart. It is your own, it shall be your royal throne. And give me, O God, an abundance of grace and mercy as I move forward to do your will. In the precious and holy name of Jesus, I ask it. And for his sake, I pray.
Thank you. Bye-bye, my children.